Praise the Lord, everybody. Have you come ready to worship this morning? Have you come ready to worship this morning? Amen.
Jesus, oh, Once you get here and you get in the presence of God, hallelujah, it makes whatever it took, it don't even matter, because we're here and we've gathered together in this place to give our God some praise. Oh, just lift those hands this morning and bless him. He's worthy. He's worthy. You're worthy, oh God. You're worthy, oh God.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon his heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, a war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broke.
hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb is overcome.
God, praise in this house. Is he alive today? Is Jesus alive today? Yes. The stone was rolled away. His glory, his manifested power. His victory. Today we want to go to the Lord in prayer. Amen. How many are happy that Jesus is alive today? Whatever your need, whatever your situation, whatever issue you may face, whatever that thing is today that you want to take to the Lord, can you raise your hand today? Do you believe that God is able? Do you believe that God is able? We sing hallelujah. We claim the victory. We walk by faith and not by sight. We walk on the promises of God and live by them that are in his word. That by faith what we endure, God will help us to get through and to overcome in the midst of tragedy, in the midst of pain, in the midst of hurts, in the midst of everything that we see. We give God praise and say hallelujah, for he's worthy of all praise.
We sing Jesus. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
We sing hallelujah.
Jesus.
We sing hallelujah.
Special prayer that we're going to do this morning. We'll call our pastor up. Amen. Give him a hand clap as he comes. Bishop Westlake. Amen.
You'll have to excuse us again. We've got, I think the house system is still out. It was on for a while. It's been out twice this morning, but it was out during the entire first service, and God moved anyway. And so there's no doubt he can do that. God is fortunately not pinned to a piece of equipment. So we will continue to bless God how we had scheduled, and if the sound comes back up, then that's an added bonus. I'm going to ask my sister Linda and her husband Kevin come up, and Roger and Brooke, if you come up and join us too. My nephew and niece, Roger and Brooke Horn, the 31st. And any of the pastors, board members, spouses, we want to ask you to come up and join us. We're going to pray a prayer of commissioning. This is my sister Linda. Some of you know her, some of you do not know her. And her husband, Kevin, who has brand new Doc Martens on today just for this. He thinks he's pretty special because of that. They have accepted a position of ministry, the executive director of business administration at a great church in Las Vegas, Nevada. And today is their last Sunday with us. So we're going to be praying a prayer of commission over them. This is their daughter, Brooke, their son, Roger III, and their daughter-in-law, Brooke. They have a few other Brooks. But we're going to pray over them and believe that God will minister through them. And they've been part of the Sheffield family for a long time. Last time we had Tribulation Christmas, she was the executive director of that production. You might remember that. So we're going to pray and believe that God will do great things through you, above and beyond, and those new shoes will work for you. So we're going to gather around and lift our voices and call out on God. Family, if you'd agree with us in prayer up here. Heavenly Father, we thank you so sincerely for all the good things you do. We don't deserve the grace you give us, none of us. We don't deserve opportunities. But you give us opportunities, you give us favor, and then you bless us and allow us to walk that way because of your strength when we depend on you. And God, I know them, I know their hearts, I know they're dependent on you solely, and I know they are believing for your working through them. And I pray that you will take them to places they have not been as they help lead this church, this body, which is a multicultural body, a lot like we have here. God, I pray that you would reach new families, new people. Yes. Help them to reach new heights. Give them financial favor and blessing. Bless them with health. As their family moves in different directions, God, I pray that you would keep your hand on them. Lead them, guide them, prosper them, and let them know that you are walking beside them and you are in their hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And I just realized that my other sister, Tina, and her husband, Marcelo, were sitting out here. They usually leave for the second service, so I'm sorry I didn't call you up. I would have. I know you love attention. She does not. And the pride and joy of my world, my son Gio is here today, but I'm not going to point out where because then he might walk out. But he's in the building. And so don't point him out. He'll leave. And a friend of his named Amy. We won't give them any more attention than that, but it's great to have them here. Pastor Ray.
Amen. Let's give our family another hand clap for Kevin and Linda, Francisco, and for God's blessing and favor to rest on them. Can you hug somebody before you take your seat? Love on somebody. Tell them it's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Amen. How many are happy to be in the house of God today? Amen. It's good to see everybody and our smiling faces. Amen. I know a lot of people aren't really into sports, but I kind of like sports. Well, how about those Kansas City Royals right now? Amen. I'm actually serious, Daniel. I'm serious. Bam, I'm real about it. I'm feeling them. I am in a real way. Amen. I'm football to the core, but I like some baseball right now. Amen. Somebody said, "Let's go Royals." I hear that organ just like it is at the stadium. Amen. That's good. I had to give my son some props just real quick. His team, the Staley Falcons, are 2-0 this year. Amen. I'm not going to say nothing else. That's my sports brief for the day. Amen. You can get some more later on if you need it. Good to see everybody. Amen. Do we have any first-time guests that are here with us today? Can you raise your hands? Any first-time guests in the house today? Give them a hand clap. No, let's give them that good Sheffield love. There's a lot of folks in the house today. I know you had to enjoy that worship. That was outstanding today. Amen. We're so glad that you decided to come and share with us here at Sheffield Family Life Center. Through these double doors to your left, we have a visitor's reception area. Please stop by there before you leave today. What a blessing that God has miraculous, beautiful things going on this day. We have some refreshments for you, and we'd love to answer any questions that you may have. There'll be a group of people to love on you and meet you there. So thank you for deciding to come and share with us, and you're welcome every day, amen, to come and share with us every Sunday or any time during the week that we're here, amen. Our ushers are assembled all around our sanctuary. They have debit envelopes in their possession. Anybody that's here in the house that would like to give by means of your debit card, please raise your hands. They'd be gracious to be able to assist you, amen. What a blessing to be able to give from our hearts. You can give by any means that you like in a few short moments in our service, amen. What a blessing to be able to give unto the Lord from our hearts. Amen. We now begin our announcement segment. The support group Divorce Care for those who are going through divorce process begins Tuesday, September 8th. For more information, pick up a flyer in the lobby or call Sister Mary at our church office. If you are interested in being part of the worship team, worship man, or sound ministry for the Sheffield West Campus, please contact Pastor Nicole Hill's office at 816-241-4831. That would be extension 7131. Amen. Mark your calendar for a special evening service on October 25th when Pastor Cheryl Brady of the Potter's House of North Dallas will be our guest here in the main sanctuary. You do not want to miss it. Amen. It should be a dynamic time of worship and a good word that will come from a dynamic woman of God. Amen. If you turn your attention to our video screens, our announcements will be continuing.
The times we are stricken with the deepest astonishment of the greatness of God will be when we throw up our faces toward heaven and go, "I cannot believe you would do that for me." He was bruised but brought healing. He was pierced but eased pain. He was persecuted but brought freedom. He was dead and brings life. He has risen to bring power, and he reigns to bring peace. The grace of God is sufficient for every trial, every imperfection, every failure, and you can lay hold of the grace of God and move forward to be used of God. If I'll be obedient to him, I will see blessing reverberate God, please, throughout my family.
Going through separation or divorce is painful and traumatic. Unfortunately, few people understand what you're going through, and even fewer know how to help. That's why there's Divorce Care. Divorce Care is a comforting 13-week group led by caring people who understand what you're going through. Each week, you'll watch and discuss a video that offers hope and practical tips that you can use to stabilize and move forward.
It was just a relief.
It helps you understand
what you're going through.
You know, why you couldn't eat, why you had no energy.
I was given time in every class to talk about the pain.
I could be me and no one would judge me.
The divorce care became a lifeline.
Amen. Let's give God some praise, for God is good. Amen. God's doing some exciting things here in the house. Amen. Sheffield Women's Ministry Bible Study will be starting Wednesday, September 9th, 7 p.m. in the Koinonia. Get your books for $14 that day. Bible study ends October 28th, and they will have some cupcakes for all the ladies that attend. What a dynamic opportunity to see something powerful that God is doing. Amen. The single adult ministry will be going on an outing on Saturday, September 5th. Sign up today at the table that's in the West Lobby. Married couples family picnic is Saturday, September 12th. Mark your calendars. If you're interested, stop by the table in the West Lobby to sign up and for more details. Amen. Sunday school class, Bad Boys of the Bible, taught by Jesse Etheridge, begins September 13th at 9 a.m. in Koinonia D. Amen. A lot of great dynamic Sunday school classes that are in effect right now, amen? Shift would like to thank you for your clothing donations for their freebie event that they did a few weeks ago. They served over 35 families, amen? And blessed this Northeast area. That's a blessing, amen? Praise the Lord. It's time to get our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen? Oh, we can do a little bit better than that. It's time to get our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The author and finisher of our faith, amen? Reading out of 2 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, and this is the part that we always hear, but I want to go a little further today, the cheerful giver. But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, amen? Not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always having all sufficiency in all things may have an abundance for every good work. And I'm going to go down to the 10th verse. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness. Family, when you give, give having faith, believing that the seed that you sow is blessed. Can I get an amen here in the house? You're not giving just because. You're giving out of obedience, and God blesses that obedience. Has anybody in this house been blessed by being faithful to giving unto God? Family, it comes from the heart. And what God loves is I'm not taking out a few dollars just to put in there just because. I'm giving because I want to give unto my Lord and Savior. I sacrifice and take something to him so the blessings of God will continue to flow. If you keep giving, he'll keep pouring out blessings so we won't have room enough. Does anybody want a blessing like that in the house today? Does anybody want a blessing like that? Family, give from your heart. God sees your need, and he will bless you bountifully. Shall we bow our heads together in prayer? Lord, we just thank you right now. Lord, we thank you for the awesome privilege it is to worship you in giving. Lord, as we assemble together, each and every heart that's in this room, you see individually. And Lord, you're able to to lead us and guide us and strengthen us and touch our hearts. And Lord, it's an intimate time between us and you. Lord, I thank you for this time of worship, that the people will be obedient. Your servants will hear from you and give from their hearts. We give you all praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone said together, amen.
And there you have it. It's beautiful. It's kind of like in Raiders of the Lost Ark when they finally opened the ark. It's beautiful. That was a decent graphic with some music to it that I was going to do a interpretive dance to, but since it's not playing, I won't. I felt the anointing for that leave. I don't think the house system is on right now, is it? I think it's just these two little speakers. Can you hear in the back? Somewhat? Okay, well, we'll get through it. It went on for a little while. It teased us for just a little bit. It came on and then has since turned back off. And we are in process of getting a new system in, but getting on that schedule and getting that done is a time-consuming thing. So we have the money in, the system will be going in, and hopefully we won't have to deal with this too much longer. Thank you for your patience and your grace. Starting a new series today, 23, the 23 series, and it's kind of interesting because you're supposed to get wiser as you get older, but I am learning that is a fallacy because there are so many things that I still don't get. And coming into a new series and seeking God for it and believing landed on something and being passionate about it, I should have known that the enemy was going to fight a little harder than normal. But I overlooked that small piece. And I don't know about you, but the last 2 or 3 weeks for me have been some of the most intense spiritual battle I've ever been a part of. Anybody with me on that? You've been in the middle of it? It's amazing when that happens, and we go through parts of it, and then all of a sudden we realize this could be spiritual. In the middle of the fight, we realize this could be spiritual, and it is. And I was thinking this morning, you know, I say let's praise our way out of it when you're in something, and sometimes I say it and I don't actually do it, because praise takes a little effort for me. It's not necessarily natural. Some of you are natural praisers. I'm not really that guy. I'm kind of a natural stand around the edge and watch people praise. But when we get in the middle of warfare and we praise our way out of it, things happen. Things happen. And I know you're a little afraid to clap because you don't know what I'm going to ask you to do next. I understand that, but if you're in warfare right now, and it's been that way, I'm going to ask you just to stand and praise God however you do, however you praise. You may want to clap, you may want to worship, you may want to yell out, however you praise, praise your way through it. If you're in the middle of warfare and there's battle going on in your life and your home and your workplace, praise your way through it. Praise your way through it. If there's sickness in your life, praise your way through it. Now, if you can remember that tomorrow, if you can remember that this afternoon and tomorrow when that hits you again, and I know it seems like a real churchy thing, but you can take that praise with you because praise flows out of your heart. It flows out of the worship of who you are. And you know, it is emotion, but it's also a spirit. There's also a spirit that comes from within, that's the Spirit of God, that drives us to that. And some of you don't look like you're worshiping, but you are. Your outside says, I'm watching TV. But inside, you're worshiping. I get that, and that's okay too, because we don't all have to worship the same, and I love that about God. He doesn't make us all, you know, become cookie-cutter people. But I tell you this, and I tell myself, worship your way through it, as difficult as it might be. If we somehow can praise God through it, I don't remember which one of our associates preached it. One of them preached, if you praise God before you get there, if you praise God as you're going through it, before you get to the victory, if we praise God before we get there, something happens. Because somehow, in some small human way, it says, God, I trust you to get me through this, even though I'm in the thick of it right now. It may be ugly today, but tomorrow I'm believing the clouds are going to roll back and we're going to see some of the sunshine. Because here's a really cool fact that we don't think about too often. You realize the sun shines every day the same. We just don't always see it. But it's shining every day. Sometimes we just need those clouds rolled back so we can see it. And I'm believing that God will do some of that for you as you look to Him before you get the victory. Thank you so much. You may be seated. You may stand. Exactly. It's just really unique how you feel a release with praise. It really is awesome. And as much as we praise here at Sheffield, we still probably don't do it enough. I don't do it enough. I'll speak for me. I don't do it enough. As you know, I do it when I feel worship. I'll worship when I feel worship. Right now, I don't feel it. Now I do. Now I don't. Now I do. It needs to be consistent. So I'm still working on that. But I've come a long way because I worship a whole lot more than I used to, and I love worship now, and it's awesome. I actually look forward to it every Sunday because I don't know about you, but with my week, I need a conversion experience every Sunday morning. I need to rediscover the love and grace of Jesus Christ every Sunday morning. Maybe you just live like you on a cloud, smoking some glorious e-cigarette. That's not me. 23. I had somebody text me this week and say, is this a series about Michael Jordan? I said, I wish. No, it's not, and I don't wish. But it's what we're going to do, we're going to look at the 23rd Psalm from a shepherd's vantage point. There are a lot of things in there. Most of us have heard it a certain way. We've heard it broken down. You know, if you've been in church for longer than a year, you've heard somebody break down the 23rd Psalm on some level, either in service or in a class or something. We're going to break it down a little different way, a little differently, and look at it from a shepherd's point of view. And there are some different facets when we do that, because David was writing from a shepherd's vantage point. He had insight into that whole world and that the function of that we don't have. Most of us have never seen a real shepherd, and we certainly don't know one to actually have conversation with. I've seen a few, I'll tell you about in a little bit, but I don't know any. So this is a shepherd's vantage point of the 23rd Psalm. This is undoubtedly the most famous psalm of all of them. It was written later in David's life. We don't know exactly how old he was. He lived to be approximately 70. We don't know how old David was when he wrote this, but we know he had been through some things, so it was later in life. It was not when he was 17. We kind of picture just David the shepherd sitting out on the hillside writing this as he's a teenager. He just polished off Goliath, and now he's back in the field, and he happens to write this. It wasn't like that. David had experienced wins and losses. He had experienced pain. He had experienced victory. He had had enemies. So we know this was later in life because he lost children. He lost favor. He lost the favor of God at points. David had been through a lot of things, and he had had great victories and huge defeats, and this was penned after he had experienced all of those things. So you can assume that it's probably the second half of his life, maybe either the last third or fourth of his life, when he wrote the 23rd Psalm. And as we're looking at this, We'll start off, and we're just going to break it down verse by verse through the week. Some of it will be a little bit more like teaching. Some of it may be more like preaching. But we know the first part. The Lord is my shepherd. If you're looking at it from a shepherd's point of view, you're going to say, I am the shepherd. I am your shepherd. I am your shepherd. Sheep are solely dependent on the shepherd and on the capabilities of the shepherd to lead them. Sheep can only go as far and only go to the places that the shepherd leads. Their provision, their health, their safety, their well-being, their direction, their very livelihood depends on the shepherd. Sheep are solely dependent on the shepherd. And we don't really like the thought of being compared to sheep, most of us. I was thinking last night, I have never known of a sports team, a mascot for any organization, school, or anything else that was a sheep. You have Falcons, Eagles, Kings, Royals, Vikings, Rams, Jayhawks, Tigers. You have Lions and Tigers and Bears. You do? Birds of Prey, Titans, Cougars, Cubs. Cubs will eat sheep. But there are no sheep. You can go out to Arrowhead next week and hear them do their war cry. Oh, you can hear that. If we were the sheep, you would have to hear this. That's really not going to strike fear in the opponents of anybody. Calm down. Back off. Nobody really aspires to be a sheep. I know there's a high school, and believe it or not, there's a high school in Illinois. Their mascot is a pretzel. I kid you not. The New Berlin Pretzels. Mr. Salty is their mascot. You can look it up online. I want the t-shirt. The pretzels. I would take a pretzel over a sheep. Fight, pretzels, fight. Come on, pretzels, win. Twist them up, tie them up. I can't shut it off. Nobody uses a sheep. Say this with me. He's the shepherd. I'm the sheep. We don't aspire to be the conquering sheep because sheep don't conquer. The shepherd does. See, sheep are basically helpless, easily frightened. They're defenseless because they are solely dependent. Turn to the person next to you and say, solely dependent. Solely dependent. Sheep are solely dependent on the shepherd. I was in Ireland a few years ago, driving between northern and southern Ireland, and it's just as you've seen in pictures. Everything is green, rolling hills, and the thing that we Americans were so captivated with was the flocks of sheep. Because to them, that's like seeing a pack of dogs run through the city. For us, it was a brand new thing. We saw these sheep, and the awesome thing was they had a shepherd, a real shepherd. And so we're all going, look, there's some sheep with a shepherd. And they're going, yeah, so? We don't ever get to see that. And one of the outstanding things, the only real outstanding piece of this whole thing was the shepherd. Because the sheep had their heads down almost the whole time, everywhere they went. As they traveled, as they ate, they grazed, they walked like this with their heads down. They'd look up and they would walk with their heads down. What you noticed when you looked at the flock of sheep was the shepherd. The shepherd was the thing that got your attention. The shepherd is what stood out. And so many times we sheep get together and it's about the sheep and it needs to be about the shepherd. So many times in life we move forward and we make it about the sheep and it's not about the sheep. The outstanding thing about Christianity or following Christ is not supposed to be us, it's supposed to be the shepherd. But it's very difficult for us to aspire in our hearts to be a sheep. Sheep are helpless. But there are things we're supposed to take as provocation to live like this. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 tells us, trust in the Lord with all your heart, lean not on your own understanding, and all your ways acknowledge Him. He'll direct your path. Give everything to Him. Be solely dependent on Him. The New Testament is solely dependent on Him. The Old Testament, all of the great leaders would get to a point where they had to be solely dependent on God. God wants us to be solely dependent on Him, and He will allow us, He will even lead us to places that will create that in our heart. I don't love when God allows me or leads me to a place that creates a need for me to be solely dependent on Him. Because that usually means things are falling apart around me. Things are out of my control. And like I said, we try to make it about the sheep oftentimes. And it's not about us. Sheep are two things I'm going to give you. Number one, they're easily distracted. Sheep are easily distracted. They wander. Sheep are famous wanderers. Any of you easily distracted in the house? I am easily distracted. If I'm in a restaurant and somebody that looks like they could be some kind of terrorist in any form or any fashion comes in, I'm watching them the whole time. It doesn't matter what's on my plate. I'm just like... Somebody comes here on a Sunday morning. Somebody walks in here, and they're lugging a backpack that looks like it has some sort of weaponry in it. I'm watching them the whole time. Even though security is, I am too. I'm easily distracted. I can be like, hey, wow, look at that. And stand there and stare at it for 20 minutes until something else distracts me. I am horribly sheep-like. Easily distracted. Easily swayed, easily taken off course. And we wander. Left to our own, we wander. Peter in 1 Peter chapter 2 says, all we like sheep have wandered off. He understood that was cultural. Sheep wander off. If you leave them to themselves, they will wander off. Without the shepherd, the sheep will be lost. Without the shepherd, the sheep will never survive. Sheep are easily distracted. And in the church, what happens is we get distracted as sheep and we begin to pursue our own interests rather than God's interests. We feel like we have to prove ourselves. We have to create platform for ourselves. It's about our goals. You know, a church service and a church setting is not really a beauty pageant, a talent show, or a gym. It can become all of those things when we're a bit distracted. Because truthfully, there should just be one reason we come to the house of God. To worship God. And it doesn't matter what I'm wearing. It doesn't matter what my hair looks like. It doesn't matter if you've got a hat on or no hat on. It doesn't matter if you have sunglasses sitting on the top of your head. It doesn't matter if you have shoes with no socks and your feet stink. When we come to the house of God, it's not a fashion show. And it's not a gym where we flex on other people. We come to the house of God to do one thing, to worship God, to connect with God. And some of you like to dress up and some of you don't. And I say, do your thing. Do your thing. But don't cast your judgment on other people. But it becomes about us. When we get distracted, it becomes about us. The shepherd isn't impressed. You know, people, one of the things that distracts me is the way people worship. You know, I can easily get distracted by the way people worship. Like people who lay on the ground, and occasionally we'll have somebody do the worm across the front. I find that distracting. He's worshiping. He's doing the worm. It's wormship. I'm distracted by other people's worship. People who lay before the Lord kind of distract me. But that's still good. I just don't happen to be one. My knees, I abused my body so bad when I was younger in sports, I can't kneel for very long without a lot of pain in my knees. And so I have to move around. I have to stand up. And, you know, so I can be easily distracted because when I'm standing up, I'm looking around. It's much easier to focus when you're knelt down and your hand is covering your face. We get distracted and it becomes about us. God's not impressed with our gifts. God's not impressed with our talent. God is not impressed with our intellect. We don't impress the shepherd when we can baa louder than everybody else. Baa. That doesn't impress God. What he's impressed with is one thing: sheep who can follow him. God is impressed with sheep who can follow. Sheep who will follow. Because another thing we deal with in Christianity and following Christ is this whole I'm not moving persona. No, I've got what I need. I'm not moving. I will not move. I will not do what you want. I will analyze everybody else and everything else. Well, let me tell you, when you have your issues, stop blaming other sheep. We hear it way too often. If you've got a problem, if I've got a problem, I'll blame some other sheep. It's easy to blame the sheep across the pasture. Or we blame the shepherd. Well, God, if you would have done this, if you would have done that, it's easy to blame some other sheep or the shepherd. But you know what I have found every single time? When I have an issue in my heart, it's me. Every single time. When I have an issue with a person, guess who it is? It's me. Because I'm the one laying in my bed thinking about it. I'm the one waking up thinking about it. I'm the one playing out scenarios and all the bad things and good things and not so either or that I'm going to do. All the possibilities. Well, when they move the pawn to the next step, then I will move the queen. And ridiculous. It's my problem. I need to stop blaming other sheep. We need to stop blaming other sheep and stop blaming the shepherd. Because if we're following God, we're going where he's going. That didn't get as many applause as it should have. If we're following God, we are going where he's going. If you're not going where God is going, you might not be following God. God is not impressed with sheep that don't follow. Don't blame other sheep. Don't blame the shepherd. Look at yourself. We need to be sheep that follow and encourage other people to follow. And when we get distracted, we need to look back at the shepherd, not at the footprints of other people. The shepherd. You know, when I was younger, I worked for two or three people who were very, very rigid. And by that, I mean, you had to do everything a certain way, at a certain time, the right way. You had to show up in a suit and tie every day. Had to do this, had to do that, had to do this. And I struggled with it because sometimes I struggle to take direction. For instance, you'll know you struggle to take direction a little bit if you're one of those people and somebody says, you know what? Even if they're your boss or your supervisor, if they say, you know what, you need to do this right now, and you just go, okay. You need to get over here and do this now. When they say the magic word now, instead of the magic word please, If you struggle with direction, when they say now, you probably say no. You take the W off and say no. You know what? You need to do this now. Give me a minute. Now. 30 seconds. Now. You just wasted 5 seconds. Well, I ended up working with people like that a lot because I needed that in my life. I needed to work with somebody who would say, well, you know what? You can choose not to do this, and you can also choose not to get paid this week. And if you don't choose to do it next week, we won't pay you all month. And if you don't do what I ask you to do or tell you to do, guess what? We've got a door that says exit over the top of it. Walk out and make sure it doesn't hit you on the way out. Because we can find, here's the killer when they say, we can find a dozen more just like you. There are a whole bunch more just like you and maybe better. And we won't have to look very far. I worked for people like that, and you probably have too. And you mumble a lot. I did a lot of mumbling. And I did a lot of saying no under my breath. But if you're going to succeed, you end up doing what you're asked to do. You end up doing what you're told to do. You follow direction, as difficult as it is. I follow direction. I have meetings I sit in now with people who are a lot more powerful than me, and they make statements, and I just think, really? Come on, that's not going to work. God will lead me directions, and I say, come on, that's not going to work. And he says, by the way, who are you? Who are you? Meh. 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 That's who I am. People like to ask you that. Do you know who I am? Don't make the mistake of asking God that question. Because he will show you. That whole God chastens those he loves, I don't like that. He chastises us. And he's done it to me, and he's done it again recently to me. You know, I try to be very transparent with you as deeply as I can be. I have gone through a season recently where God is just stripping me down in so many weird ways. And it is not fun. It's not fun. Some of you are smiling right now. Don't smile too big. God knows your heart. And you can be taken down, player. But God has stripped me down. And he'll do it again. And again. And again. Because I keep trying to roar rather than bang. Bad. Don't. Bad. Don't roar. God takes us places if he loves us. He teaches us to follow. And I'll tell you one thing God does, and he's done it to me again recently with everything I've been doing, as I've had, I don't say much to you, I've had amazing favor in amazing circles the last year for no good reason. And God has let me know very vividly that all of those circles can be erased very quickly. And you know what I have to do, and this is part of the breaking down process, you have to give it all back to him. Whatever favor he's given you, whatever grace he's given you, whatever position he's given you, whatever money he's given you, whatever brain power you think you have, whatever looks you think, some of you think you're God's gift to creation in the way you look, you stand in the mirror and gaze upon yourself. Someday you will get fat. It will happen. It hits everybody at different times. And when it comes to your house, it is not fun. Please jump on me, smother me in it. No. God will strip you down. And he will show you that everything he's given you, you better give back to him. Because if you don't, I'm telling you this from as your brother walking with you, if you don't give it back, you will lose it. If you don't give it back to God, you'll lose it. Because we can't handle what God gives us. Our integrity will not stay afloat with the gifts that he gives us. We don't have it. None of us are good enough to handle gifts that God gives us. If God has given you favor, you better thank him for it, and you better find an altar to lay it on and give it back to him. is those of you who have been in position and been out of position, been in favor and been out of favor, you know it can be gone tomorrow. Everybody can love you today and hate you tomorrow. So what do? We follow. We follow. We follow, and we learn to watch the shepherd. And it's not easy, because I'm distracted. I want to watch something else. I want to watch the other sheep. I want to see how they're following. I want to rate them. I want to rate the way they're following. No, it's not about that. It's about me following Christ. It's about you following Christ. It's the shepherd saying, I am your shepherd. I am your shepherd. Now follow me. We're easily distracted. We are the sheep. We follow. And we're easily disconcerted. Chapter 23, verse 1 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. That's the traditional verbiage. But it's actually him saying to us, I am your shepherd. I have everything you need. And that reminds us, it's not me, it's him. I have everything you need. See, we go through situations and we don't feel like God has what we need. David did too. See, David spoke this knowing both sides. This is the guy who killed Goliath, but he also hid in caves from people that he should have been able to defeat. I am your shepherd. I have everything you need. And watching a flock of sheep follow a shepherd, you realize that they are completely dependent on the shepherd. If the shepherd leads them off the edge of a cliff, they will go. If the shepherd leads them into water that is so deep they'll drown, they will go. Because they are solely dependent on the shepherd. He has everything they need. We'll get into some of the other pieces of this, and some of them are really fascinating from a shepherd's viewpoint in the coming weeks. But this last thing today, he says, I am your shepherd. I have everything you need. Now, David, in his later years, we don't have any documentation of this, but we are people of memories and things that mean something to us. We hold on to those. We think about them. We share them with other people. So undoubtedly throughout David's life, because he was a teenager when he fought Goliath. So undoubtedly throughout David's life, there were points when he went back to it, probably many points when he saw himself back in the valley of Elah. Walking down into that valley with the army of the Israelites and the army of the Philistines all watching him. They had their hero out there, Goliath. The Israelites had a boy out there, a teenage young man out there. And Goliath said, I come to you with a sword, a spirit, and a javelin. A sword, a spear, and a javelin. And what did David say? I come to you in the name of the Lord. In the name of the Lord. So now put this in Psalm 23. I am your shepherd. I have everything you need. David had a sling and some stones. Walking in to battle a man who was an experienced warrior with a sword, a spear, and a javelin. And he knew from his own experience that God, the shepherd, had everything he needed. And I'm telling you today, whatever you walk into, God has what you need. If you are following Christ, if you are a sheep who is following the shepherd, or even attempting to, God has everything you need. When the enemy comes into your mind and says, he doesn't have it for you, he can't carry you through this one, he can't make it happen for you, let me tell you for sure, God has everything you need. When you have physical sickness, God has everything you need. When you have financial difficulties, which every one of us in this room has, God has everything you need. When you have relational problems, God has everything you need. And you will have days when that doesn't feel like the truth. And as a sheep, you will be tempted to do what? Be distracted and wander. Well, this is going on, and obviously God's not going to help you. I'll look over here. I'll listen to this person. I will listen to preachers all day on the radio. I'll watch them on TV. I'll get on YouTube and listen to sermons. I'll talk to my friends. I'll talk to my family members. We consult everybody we can. You know, in the day we live in, people pursue preachers and ministries all over the world for the looking for the word they need. I'm just going to keep listening until I get the word I need from somebody. That's not it. We hear a lot about bigger churches, but we have more churches dying in the American culture than any time in our recent history. There are churches dying every day because people say, you know what? I'm going to look somewhere else for what I need to another thing, another type of faith, another person. I have people who tell me, well, you know, Pastor, I go to church at home. I watch Joel Osteen on TV. I go to church at home. I watch T.D. Jakes. I watch the bishop. I do this. I do that. You know what? And that's great. But sitting at home in your Walmart clothes, in your shopping clothes, pajamas, and Crocs, sitting at home eating a Pop-Tart, watching Joel Osteen is not going to give you the same spirit experience as entering the house of God. It's just not. Because there's something about the presence of the Lord. And every once in a while, it comes through the TV screen, but not too often. It's in you. And we're told not to forsake the gathering of the body of Christ for a reason. Because there's energy, there's passion, there's worship, there's edification that takes place when we come together. And no, you don't have to go to church to be a Christian, but I would put my money on the square that says if you are a Christian, you'll do better if you go to church. Because what happens is we get distracted and we become that sheep that drifts off. And we say, I'm okay. Yeah, you're okay now, but what about when the predator comes? Because you have an enemy. If you are trying to pursue God, you have an enemy of your soul. And if you are not following the shepherd and you are not connected to the other sheep, you're alone. And chances are you are going to get eaten up. Because sheep don't have sharp teeth. They don't have venom. They don't have sharp claws. They have little tiny hooves that can barely support their legs. And they've got teeth that are about the size of mine. Sheep are solely dependent on the shepherd, and he has everything you need. What about your dreams? He's got them. What about your hope? He's got it. What about your provision? He's got it. What about your household? He's got it. What about your kids and your grandkids and your parents and your cousins? He's got them. He's got them. And I know it gets tough. The closer it gets to your house, the more difficult it gets. You know, we can tell everybody what to do until it comes to our house. I've got all the answers till it's in my room. It's in your room and he's got the answers. What do you do? It's real simple. You're following like a sheep. You follow him and you look at him, and if he says, we're going this way, you go that way. Because God knows what's ahead, and we don't. We can't see tomorrow. We can't see next week. God knows. And he will lead you accordingly. And if you're going through a tough time, maybe you need to go through a tough time. Because tough times make us stronger. They're not easy, but they strengthen our faith. When I go through a tough time, I come out of it and I have fewer friends, but I've got more faith in God. I used to have so many friends, I had to put them in alphabetical order to think through them. Now I can count them on half a finger. But my faith in God is like it's never been. He's got you. Stand with me if you would, please. Prayer partners, altar workers, if you could join me in the front, that would be greatly appreciated. very expediently, before you walk out the door today, you might say, you know what, I need to establish this shepherd-sheep relationship in my life. I need to be a follower of Jesus Christ. I need that in my life. I need to be a follower of Christ today. Or maybe you have had that relationship and you have been distracted and you've kind of drifted away. If there's been drifting, it's not God, it's you. And you can come back to center with that very easily. You say, I need to establish that relationship with God in my heart today. I need to reestablish. I need to reset the guidelines. But I need God to do something in my heart today. Before you walk out these doors and go back into your reality, which undoubtedly has some challenges, you need to reestablish or establish relationship with God today. Or maybe you just need that power that comes through agreement with people who are people of prayer and people of faith. I'm going to ask you to join this lady who has already made her way down. We just want to pray with you. Just pray with you. Lead you to Christ, lead you to reestablishment of that relationship, lead you back to center. Maybe you're here today and you say, you know what, at one point the Lord was my shepherd, but He's not today. Allow us to pray with you and bring that directive, that guidance back into your heart, back into your life, back into your spirit. And God is able. God is able. As He is your shepherd and He has everything you need. He is able. He is able. We're going to need a few more prayer partners up here. If you're a ministry leader or involved in ministry and know how to lead someone to Christ or pray with them, could use your help. I'm going to have you do one more thing very quickly. Turn to the person on either side of you and say, if you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. Lead them to a place. Lead them to a place of restoration. If you want to go down and pray, I'll go with you. Walk them down to a place of restoration today before they leave the building. Let's give God a hand. Let's celebrate God. Let's celebrate the shepherd a little bit. Celebrate who He is and what He does. Remember as you go through this week, remember tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, remember He's your shepherd. He's your shepherd. He has everything you need. God bless you. Have a great week.